Come on. Come on, put your hands together. Let's sing this out. We're giving it all away, away. Hey, hey. We're giving it all to go your way. Hey. We're giving it all away, away. Hey, hey. We're giving it all to go your way. Father. In the Father, there is freedom, there is hope in the name that is Jesus. Lay your life down, have it all now. We are found in the love of a Savior. We've come alive in you, set free to show the truth. Our lives will never be the same. We're giving it all. Everything that we are for your glory. Take our hearts now, have it all now. Let our life shine your light like the morning. We've come alive in you, set free to show the truth. And our lives will never be the same. We're giving it all away, away. Hey! Giving it all. Sing together. I was lost with a broken heart. You picked me up and now I'm set apart. For me I shine born. Forever safe in the Savior's sins. You're more than moments can say. I'll follow you though for all my day. I'll fix my eyes following you. Forever free in unending grace. Here we go. 'Cause you are my freedom. We lift you higher, we lift you higher. You love, never ending hope. Oh, you are alive in us. Nothing can take your place. You Come on, we sing in the midst.
In the midst of the darkest night.
Come on.
Let your love be the shining light.
Breaking
chains that were holding me. You sent your son down to set me free. Everything of this world will fade. Pressing on till I see your face. And I believe that you will be done.
I won't stop.
I won't stop till your kingdom come.
Come on.
Cause you are my freedom. We lift you higher, we lift you higher. Your love, never ending. Oh, yeah. You are alive in us. Nothing can take your place. You are all we need. Your love has set us free.
Everybody dance. Come on, we sing this out, we sing you are.
Cause you are my freedom. Here we go.
Cause
you are my freedom. We lift you higher, we lift you higher. Your love, never ending. Oh, oh, you are alive in us. Nothing can say. Your place, you are all we need. Your love has set us free. You are alive in us. Nothing can take your place. You are all we need. Your love has set us free. Whoa.
Come on, put your hands together. All right, we tried this last night, a couple nights ago. We need you guys' help again. Come on, can you sing this out with me? Sing, whoa. I feel like you guys aren't giving me everything you got.
That's good, Chase.
I feel like you guys just have more.
Yeah.
I feel like you guys can sing louder. I feel like you can lose your voice more. So what we're going to do is we're going to give it everything we got, okay? All right. One chance. We got to give it everything we got. Here we go. You ready? 1, 2, 1, 2, 3, 4. Whoa, oh, oh.
Whoa.
Okay. Yeah. Whoa, oh, oh.
Things to the answer.
joyful shout of praising with all of the music, praising with all of the nations, praising with all of creation. We praise him, we praise him, praising with all of your heart. Say, praise him in this generation. Jesus, the light of salvation. We praise him, we praise, we praise him, we praise him, we praise him, we praise him, we praise him. Shine your light forever and ever. Shine your light forever and ever. Shine your light, shine your light in the world. Shine your light forever and ever. Shine your light forever and ever. Shine your light, shine your light in the world. One more time, shine your light. Shine your light forever and ever. Shine your light forever and ever. Shine your light, shine your light in the world. Praise him with all of the music, praise him with all of the nation, praise him with all of creation. We praise. Praise him with all of your heart. Say, praise him in this generation. Jesus, the light of salvation. We praise him, we praise. Here we go. Whoa, oh, oh. Whoa, oh, oh. Whoa, oh, oh. Whoa, oh, oh. Whoa, oh, whoa, oh, whoa, oh, oh. Whoa, oh, oh.
Amen. Last night of camp, how we doing? That's right. Come on. Let's put the hands together. See, we found love.
We found love. That never runs dry. From the depths to the sky, our eyes fixed on the one who knows no end. Stand strong. He stands strong for all of time. In the joy, in the trial, 'cause you are the beginning and the end.
Come on.
'Cause your love goes on. Your love goes on. Ever ours will see Jesus in everything. From the sky to ocean deep, your love goes on. Through every rise and fall, we are forever yours. One thing we know is sure, your love goes on and on. To the night, you're here with us, you're on our side. Your arms are forever open wide. You stand strong for all the time. In the joy, in the trial, 'cause you are the beginning and the end.
Come on, we lift him up.
'Cause your love
goes on. Your love goes on. Ever our will see Jesus in everything. From the sky to oceans deep, your love goes on. Through every rise and fall, we are forever yours. One thing we know is sure, your love goes on and on and on.
May we sing Love Unfailing.
Love unfailing, never shaken, hope awakens in you, you. Love unfailing, never shaken, hope awakens in you, you. Love unfailing, never shaken.
Together, sing this out.
In love you give everything upon the cross. You bled for me to show the mercy of your heart.
Sing all my life.
Forevermore.
this to our Father in heaven. Hallelujah, Jesus, we love you. We love you, we love you, we love you. God, we surrender. We surrender our heart, we surrender our lives. God, we can't go without you. We can't continue without you. God, we give to you, Lord. We give to you, Lord. All over this place tonight, would you just take the next couple of seconds and just begin to surrender to God. Just give it up to him. All to you. Every part of my life, every part of my world. love that illustration, because when we lift our hands, what we're saying is, whoa, you got this. You're in charge, God. You have your way. You only have one night left, but in this last night, I'm believing that what God does, that its impact doesn't remain within this building, but that it stretches into every city and town, into every high school, into every college campus, into every home, a broken home, foster home. And so let's just give it to God. Let's just tell him, God, I know we only have one night left, but I'm believing you can do something big tonight. So have your way with me. Have your way with me. Do with me what you will tonight, God. Because if you can do it in my life, and if it becomes real in my life, and I will never be the same again. And I know that if I'm never the same again, my city, my town will never be the same again. Change me, and I can change my home. Change me, and I can change my home. We keep asking the Lord to change our homes, and we keep asking the Lord to change our schools, but really, the prayer needs to be, God, change me so that I can change my home, so that I can change my school, so that I can change my situation. Have your way. God, we surrender, we surrender, we surrender. We ask you to take control and to take charge tonight. We love you. In the beautiful name of your Son, Jesus Christ, we pray. And everyone says, amen. Can head back to your seats. Yeah, but on your way back, tell five people, five, exactly five. Tell them, it ain't over. Tell them, it ain't over. It ain't over. Five people. Exactly five people. It ain't over. Thanks, Petey. Yeah, dude, definitely. It's the last day of camp. Everybody say, oh. Come on, how many people have having the time of their life this week? Yeah. How many people God did something special in your life last night? Amen. So beautiful to see. So beautiful to see. People in God's presence just refusing to leave. Just loving on Jesus and letting Jesus love on them. I'm so grateful for having the chance to be with you guys. I love the Northwest. I love the students. I love the leaders. And just on behalf of my wife and I, thank you for loving us and being so kind and always saying hello and good morning and good afternoon and talking. And we're really, really super blessed to be with y'all. And on this last night of camp, I think nobody asked me to do this, but I just think it's so important because there's so much work that goes into this, guys. Could you do me a favor? Could you make some noise for all of the leaders and directors and who put on the work to do this camp? It is no joke, man. All the media guys, all the sound guys, Tyler, everybody who's worked so hard. And it's a lot of work. It's a lot of effort. And they do it, and they do it smiling. It was really interesting during the volleyball game today, leaders volleyball game, which stole a portion of my manhood today. Thank you very much. Just did not know that it was going to be Olympic volleyball that you guys were going to be playing, okay? I didn't know you were on that level. I thought it was recreational, but became a lot more serious real quick. You could even see during the games just people losing points and people, you know, hitting the net, and nobody was upset on the outside. You know, they were able to lock it in because they knew students were watching and leaders were watching. So they were like, good shot, good shot, good shot. You know, but on the inside, they're like, get off. But you know, but those are your leaders, man. They want to put on a good example, then they're doing just a phenomenal job. And if you made noise for your directors, can you make some special noise for Pastor Micah and Erica, your DYDs, who you don't get enough credit. They don't get enough credit. They give their lives for week after week after week after week. And it's a lot of work, man. It's a lot of work, and it's a heavy burden. Somebody gets hurt, instantly they're caring. Instantly they're wondering what's going on. And so it's a lot to carry. Anybody like my shirt? Come on. Who does not, raise your hand if you do not have an NW Youth shirt yet. Raise your hand. Okay, you need to get a shirt before you leave tonight because they will be all sold out. So make sure you get a shirt. I don't get commission, okay? I don't get 10%. They do not tithe to me. I just think it's important that we rep and we just take on that identity. It's great to go to a church, but it's even better to be a part of a family of churches. You know what I mean? I love my church, but I really love my network, and I really love my district. And when you buy a shirt, you support that network of churches, and so that's really really important and really special, and make sure you do that, all right? Hey, I want to get right into the Word tonight. I almost don't want to because I want the week to just keep going, but we can't. We got to close it down eventually, and tonight's that night, but we're going to end on a good note. If you have a Bible, I want you to turn to the book of Ezekiel, chapter 36, verse 26. If you don't have a Bible, I'm hoping we have the slides on the screen. Maybe not. I'm not sure. Ezekiel, chapter 36. We got them. Come on. Chapter 36, verse 26. Goes like this. I will give you a new heart. Somebody say new heart. And I will put a new spirit. Someone say new spirit. In you. I will remove from you your heart of stone. Someone say heart of stone. And I will give you a heart of flesh. Someone say heart of flesh. All right, I'm going to say it one more time. And I just want you to just listen and let it sink in. Let those words sink in. Because that's what we'll be talking about tonight. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. Would anybody do me a favor? Why don't you take your right hand and put it over your heart right now? Let's just pray. We've prayed a lot. We've been worshiping a lot. But let's just ask God to do something in our heart tonight. And if that doesn't make sense, it'll make sense in about 25 seconds. But just pray with me, all right? Bow your heads, close your eyes. Father, we love you and we thank you, God. We ask that you would do something special tonight in our hearts. Last night, you renewed our spirit, and that was awesome. But tonight, God, I'm believing that you want to renew our heart. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. You know, I believe that God wants to do two things in the life of every human being. A, he wants to give them a new spirit. And B, he wants to give them a new heart. Last night we preached about the Holy Spirit, and there were a lot of students who were baptized in the Holy Spirit for the first time. It was a beautiful moment. We got to see a lot of people just connect and love God, and God loved on you, and that's awesome. But here's how you know if what you experienced last night is authentic and genuine. If with that new spirit came a new heart. Let me explain the difference really quickly. A spirit is what you have that helps you love God, but a heart is what you have that helps you love people. And I think that it's real easy sometimes to come to camp and to fall in love with God. But then when you leave camp and go back to the difficult people, it's kind of hard to love people the way you loved God. I mean, we're supposed to love God more than we love people, but we're also supposed to love people. That was a problem for me growing up because I grew up in a Latino, Hispanic, Pentecostal church. What that means is every service ended in some type of awesome manifestation of the Holy Spirit, which was really cool when it wasn't crazy. Some days there would be people getting filled with the Spirit and just doing like bicycle kicks, like off the wall. Like it was some banana stuff. Like before breakdancing was cool, like people were breakdancing at the altar. And I didn't mind that. I didn't mind that because I understood that when God does things, he does things big and he does things crazy. So I didn't mind that. What bothered me was those same people who were dancing and backflipping and cartwheel and bicycle cycling in the air and all those crazy stuff. I didn't mind that they were doing that. What bothered me was that those same people would then go out into the community, go back into their home, go back into the school like nothing ever happened. Rude to people, ignoring people, back in their craziness. And it's like, man, I don't mind if you're weird at church, but just be weird at Walmart too. You know what I'm saying? Like, I know a guy who's weird at church and weird at Walmart, and I love him. I can't hang out with him, but I love him. His name is Pastor Edgar. He's actually I just finished being DYD last year, and he actually took over for me. He's an awesome dude. He's weird at church and weird at Walmart. He's the guy who, in the middle of church, when the pastor just says good morning, he's like, hallelujah, gloria a Dios, like speaking in tongues and just like, and like, it was like, all he said was good morning, you know, like chill, like bring it down, like it's early, nobody's had their coffee, you know, he just shouts the preacher down, and so he's weird at church. But he's also weird at Walmart. We went paintballing one day, and it was, you had to pick between two color paintballs, and I picked the blue paintballs, and then the lady comes behind the counter and she's like, well, what kind of paintball color do you want? And he's like, I want red for the blood of Jesus. and the lady behind the counter is like, okay, let me get 75 red. And then when she gives him the paintballs, he just starts to like preach the gospel. And I'm over there next to him and I'm like, dude, we're just paintballing, bro. She didn't sign up for this, man. This isn't her job to hear you preach. She said, and he has this wristband that says, you know, I love Jesus on it or something like that. Or one of those Christian wristbands. He takes it off and he gives it to her with the money for the paintballs. And he just tells her, I just want you to know Jesus loves you. And in my mind, and I might have even said it out loud, I was like, you're so freaking weird, bro. I can't go anywhere with you, man. You know? But then I read the Bible, and I wonder, if Jesus were to walk around today, would he be the weird one, or would I be the weird one? Would Jesus and the apostles look at Edgar and say, man, great job. Jesus touched your life. I can see what you're doing. That makes total sense. Of course you'd want to let the world know. Or would he look at me and all of the hundreds of people I pass by on a daily basis and never share the gospel? I wonder who's really weird. You know what I mean? And I feel like that's just a part of what God does in your life. When you know that God has really changed your heart or really given you a new spirit, when you get a new heart, they become connected one in one. My first camp ever preaching in the Northwest was at Cedar Springs Camp, which I thought was a really cool camp until I came to Silver Lake. And then I was like, dang, Cedar Springs, y'all need a lake, because Silver Lake is pretty silver, it's nice. And I remember my first camp there on Wednesday night, we preached on the Holy Spirit. And I remember bunch of students coming to the altar and receiving and getting filled, and it was beautiful. And there was this one girl who came up to me and she said, I want to share something with you. And I already had my guard up because right before that, another girl had came up to me and she was like, I have to tell you something. I was like, yeah. She's like, I see shadows. She's like, of birds that are following me. And I was like, girl, step out the light. Just step out the light. Just be in the dark. There will be no shadows in the dark. Just get out the light. You'll be all right. So, you know, as an evangelist, you travel the town, you just kind of get your guard up when people come to talk to you at the end of service. Last night, by the way, thank you for sharing your testimonies with me. They were awesome and beautiful. But this one girl came up right after that girl. So I kind of had my guard up, and she came over to me, and she was like, hey, I want to share something with you. And I was like, yeah. She says, tears in her eyes, there's boogers running down the nose. You know God's touched you when the boogers are coming down. And she just came over, and she said, man, I got to tell you something. She said, I can feel it. And when she said, I can feel it, I said, oh, yeah, that's cool. You know, you can feel the Holy Spirit. You can feel his presence. You know, that's awesome. That's beautiful. And she said, no. She said, I can feel their pain. I said, what do you mean? She says, well, I was praying. God gave me a vision of an orphanage in Africa, and I could see all of the orphans in the home not eating and not having people love on them. And I could feel, while I was praying, I could feel their loneliness, and I could feel their desperation, and I could feel their hurt, and I could feel their brokenness. And I was just floored, because that's how you know that God really touched you. That's how you know you really got filled with his spirit. Why? Because, and I feel this is the litmus test for me, and I see it in scripture. When you can feel other people's pain, I think you know that God is inside of you in a great way. That's what I see in Jesus's life. In the book of John, let's go to the next passage of scripture really quickly. In the book of John, chapter 11, verse 33 through 35, there's a very famous story. You probably have heard it. If not, I'll give you the Reader's Digest version. It's the story of a man named Lazarus and Jesus. Lazarus was one of Jesus's really good friends. And unfortunately, Lazarus dies. And so Jesus shows up to the funeral. And when he shows up to the funeral, the preceding scene begins to take place. Verse 33, when Jesus saw her weeping, her, by the way, is Mary and Martha, the sisters of Lazarus. He's at the funeral and there's people crying, which is to be expected because it's a funeral. And the Jews who had come with her also weeping, crying. He was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. Where have you laid him? Where's his body? He asked. Come and see, Lord, they replied. And verse 35 is the shortest verse in the Bible, but it deserves its own verse. It's, and Jesus cried. And Jesus wept. For me, that is a powerful verse, a powerful scripture. And because I'll tell you why. If you don't know how the story ends, like spoiler alert, I'm sorry. He resurrects Lazarus from the dead, okay? He walks up to the tomb. He moves the stone off the tomb. And he says, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus gets up all like mummy style, wrapped in bandages. And he begins to walk again. So he comes back to life. Here's what I don't get. If I'm Jesus, that means I'm God, which means I know everything. You can't surprise Jesus, right? Jesus knows all things. He knows the past. He knows the present. He knows the future. You can't surprise Jesus. Like, it must have sucked to play hide and seek with Jesus if you were one of his brothers and sisters. He just starts counting. 1, 2, you're behind the couch. Boom, got you. Like, you don't surprise Jesus. He knows what's happening at all times. He knows the future. He knows it all. You can't surprise him. So here's the deal. Here's what I don't get. How does Jesus walk into a funeral? Listen, the funeral of the guy who he knows he's about to bring back to life and cry. Did you think about that? Because if I was Jesus and I showed up at that funeral, I'm not crying. If I'm Jesus and I showed up to that funeral, I'm wearing a hot pink suit with a big fedora hat and a big old like yellow feather and some gator boots. I want people to see me because I know what's about to go down. And I'm not crying, I'm laughing and smiling. And everybody's gonna be freaked out until the end. I'm busting through the funeral doors and I'm like, hey everybody, how's it going? Yeah, you crying? Don't cry. It's about to go down. Like, don't cry. Like, you just wait. You see what happened. Jesus, why aren't you crying? Why are you laughing? You're like, 5 more minutes. Like, 5 more minutes. I know what's going to happen. You don't know what's going to happen, but I know what's going to happen. Like, if I was Jesus, I'd be showing up to that funeral with a big old cheese smile on my face. But he cries. Why do I bring that up? Because people have often told me, well, Jesus cried because Lazarus, his friend, was dead. That can't be true. Because he knew that he was about to get brought back to life. So if he's not crying because his friend is dead, then why is he crying? And this is why I'm making a big point of it. Because if you look at verse 33, the secret is in there. Jesus does not cry because Lazarus is dead. Look at verse 33. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, then he was deeply moved. This is the beautiful thing about Jesus. He didn't cry because Lazarus was dead. He cried because he saw someone else crying. Wow. Wow. The sympathy, the empathy. I mean, Jesus is God. He's been from the beginning of time to that moment. He's seen a million tragedies. He's seen civilizations get wiped out. But none of the pain and none of the hurt that he's seen hardened his heart. He was able to still look at a woman crying and a woman whose life is just a blip on the radar of his eternal screen. He looks at her crying and he's moved to tears. When you're close to God and the Spirit of God is in you, you are moved when other people hurt. You are moved when other people have pain. Like, if you've ever been on a fast before, I remember being on like a 21-day fast with my church. And by the end of that fast, like, if a butterfly crossed my face, I was like, oh my God, Jesus, like, you're beautiful. Like, in the butterfly, I see you. Like, right? There's this sensitivity that rises up inside of you the closer you get to God. And why? Because God's heart, listen, God's heart breaks for people. And God loves people. And so when you love someone, well, let me share it with you this way. I remember one, I'm going to confess something, two things that I'm not proud of tonight. But that's okay because you won't tell anybody. So thing number one We were at a youth service, my wife and I, our youth service. And right when the youth service was over, I looked at my wife and I'm like, babe, we got to go. She was like, what's up? You got to use the bathroom? I'm like, nah. We got to go home. She's like, why? I'm like, cuz. Now, every youth pastor knows prime time in youth service is when? After the service. Because everybody's done and they want to hang out and they want to talk. And so my leadership duty was to stay there and hang out. But I abandoned my leadership duty. I was a horrible youth pastor for that night. Because I looked at my wife and said, we got to go because our show is recorded and it's the season finale of our show. Now, that is not what I'm ashamed of. What I'm ashamed of is the show that I went home to watch that was recorded. Now I know you might not have heard this show. You might have heard this show, maybe not. But it's a show that I kind of got into. And forgive me, all the men in the place. Just forgive me. Don't judge me, okay? Don't judge me, guys, okay? The show I went home to watch was a show called Project Runway, okay? Now, you with me? The guy with the Seahawks jersey is with me. Amen. Okay. Now, let me just break down this show if you've never seen this show, if you're lost, okay? The show is a show about people who design clothes for other people. It's a fashion show. They design the clothes, and then after they design the clothes, they walk down the runway, and people, you know, judge them, and they get points, and they lose. And it was the season finale, and I was dying to go see. Now, you need to understand something about me, okay? I hate fashion. I'm not good at fashion. My wife, literally, when I go out on trips, my wife literally takes pictures of the outfits that I'm supposed to wear and emails them to me, and then she puts Monday and Tuesday on each email so that when I get to the camp, I know what to wear to come preach. And if I don't have internet, I just don't go. I just don't come out. I can't come out right now. I need Wi-Fi. You know, it's just, I can't come out right now. So I hate fashion. I'm not good at it. For me, clothes, okay, we shouldn't even have them. They're a result of the fall, okay? Adam and Eve, they ate the fruit and boom, clothes were born, okay? So they're demonic just in and of themselves, all right? That's Bible for you guys right there. So I'm not a big clothes guy, not a big fashion guy, but my wife loves fashion. And when we got married, our pastor gave us some advice. He said, listen, two things. TV can be a good thing for your marriage and it can be a bad thing for your marriage. So all young people, I'm giving you some good advice when it comes to TV, okay, when you get married. He said, number one, he said, don't put the TV in the bedroom, okay? And then he said, number two, and I won't say anything else because I've been accused of stuff this week, so I won't say anything else about that, okay? And then number two, he said, and make sure you only have one TV in the house. I said, why? He said, because if you have two TVs, then you'll watch your shows on your TV and your wife will watch her shows on her TV. If you have one TV, then you guys are forced to negotiate, you guys are forced to compromise, and you're forced to spend quality time together. And that sounded like an awesome idea until football season. in which place I was like, hey, we need to watch football on Sundays and Mondays and sometimes Thursdays. And occasionally Saturday nights, but not all the time, you know, just when it's on. And she was like, okay, that's cool. But on Thursday nights, we have to watch Project Runway. And at first I hated the show, couldn't understand it. But then after years, literally 7 years of watching this show, you can't help but get into it because you're forced to sit there and watch it. Here's the point I'm making, okay? Here's the point I'm making. Listen, I ended up loving Project Runway, not because I love fashion. I hate fashion. I ended up loving the show, listen, because I loved my wife, and my wife loved the show. Listen to me. When you love somebody, their passions become your passions. When you love someone, the things that they love, if you love them, you end up loving those things. That's why it's impossible for you to come to church and say, I love God, but I'm not all about people. Well, wait. If you love God, then his passions become your passions. And let me tell you what God's passionate about. People. He loves them.
He loves them so much that he sent his own son, Jesus, to die for them. You can't love God and not love his son. You can't love me and not love my son, Justice. You can't come up to me at the end of the preaching and be like, high five, JJ, great sermon, and then drop kick my son. It doesn't work like that. You have to love my son if you love me, because that's my family. And God's the same way. He's saying, hey, I appreciate you coming to the altar, and I appreciate you getting filled with the Spirit, and I appreciate you speaking in tongues, and I appreciate you worshiping me and loving me and giving the Spirit the lie. But if you love me, you got to love my son too. And you got to love my children. And guess who? I'm the father of the world, God says. And so you got to love every human being on this planet because they're mine. When you love God, as a part of that, you got to love people. I think that's the greatest transformation ever that a human being can come in, that ever a human being can experience. The transformation of a selfish love to a love for people. It's a heart transplant. I don't think that the greatest transformation for a Christian is I used to smoke and now I don't smoke. That's cool, but you don't need Jesus to stop smoking. They make patches for that. The greatest transformation for me is not, hey, I used to suffer from headaches, but now I met Jesus and now I don't suffer from headaches. Well, that's cool, but you don't need Jesus to overcome headaches. Take an Advil. But tell me, what patch is there for selfishness? What pill is there for a cold heart? Only God, only the Spirit of God can take a person who is all about themselves and turn it to love other people. Only God. He's the only one who can do that. It's the only way that it works. And let me tell you, we are more selfish in this society than we even know. Because it has become such a norm and so regular, like even in the subtle things, like most of the people, and I'm being funny right now, but most of the people have a, you know, they don't have a U phone, they have an I phone. You know what I'm saying? Me phone. They take pictures and they post them on social media or YouTube. Right? You get it? Me? You? Come on. I'm preaching and being corny at the same time. Is you? Me? Thank you for that. Or my favorite, or actually my worst, my least favorite thing to ever see on social media, the word of 2013, selfie. Oh my goodness. Can I just tell you, I have a opposite of love affair with selfies. I don't understand it. I don't understand two things. One, why are all your selfies in the bathroom? I don't get it. Okay? Why are you always in the bathroom, always taking pictures of yourself? It's not good. It's not right. And number two, why would you even do it? It's like on Christmas when you're handing out presents and people are giving out like pajamas and underwear and PlayStations, you give everybody a picture of yourself. That's what a selfie is. You're like, I love you so much. Here's me. Okay, I got the 9-inch by 12-inch, I got the 4x6, I got the wallet size, you know, everything. I've got it, here it is for you, here's a picture of me. Like, you live in Washington, it's one of the most beautiful states in the world, and instead of taking pictures of the scenery, it's like, on my way to school. I'm being funny, but I'm being serious, because we're so much about us, like And you know what? Nobody ever has to teach us that. Like the other day, I was hanging out with my kids, and my oldest said his first four-letter word ever. Said his first four-letter word. I went crazy. He was. There was a toy that he was not playing with. Then his little brother grabs the toy, and as soon as his little brother grabs the toy, big brother wants that toy. And so he goes over and he grabs a toy and he begins to pull the toy. And the little brother is actually, he's a year younger, but he's built like a linebacker. He's actually stronger than his older brother. And so he ripped the toy from the older brother's hands, and the older brother then looks at him and says his first four-letter word. I was like, oh no, my God, no, he didn't. You know what it was? Mine. M-I-N-E. Oh yeah. And some of you say, well, that's not a four-letter word. F is a four-letter word. S is a four-letter word. C is a, you know what? I would have preferred he would have said one of those than one of the other ones, because I could spank that out of him. You know what I'm saying? Don't you ever. I can spank that out of him, and then he's done. Listen, but you can't spank the selfishness out of somebody. You can't spank the introspectiveness of somebody. You can't spank the I'm the only one in this world that I care about out of somebody. And nobody taught him that. Maybe Finding Nemo taught him that. Maybe. 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 That's why I don't watch some of those movies anymore with them. But nobody had to teach him that. You know, it was inside of him. And listen, I wish that I could say that the selfishness ends in the world, but unfortunately, and I hate to pick on you, I'm going to pick on myself. Sometimes that same exact selfishness sneaks into the church too. I remember one time I was preaching. I wasn't preaching. My pastor was preaching, and he took me with him to Connecticut. We were doing a revival out there, and we were staying at a church that couldn't afford to put us up in a hotel, so they put us up at some lady's house. And it was in the summer in Connecticut, and the lady didn't have any indoor air conditioning. And they had us sleeping in the top floor. We know the heat rises. It's like 90 degrees. We're sweating. And then my pastor, he's super spiritual. And he's like, hey, Jay, we need to get prayed up for this revival tonight. Are you going to get prayed up? I'm like, yeah, dude, I'm going to get prayed up. And I go into my room, and he goes into his room. Our rooms are right next to each other. I get on my knees. I'm like, 5 minutes, I'm done. It's so hot. I'm sweating. I'm like, I need to sleep. I need to rest. This is crazy. But I didn't want to feel guilty. And so the way of me trying to escape my guilt was this. I'm going to sneak into his room. And if he's not praying, it's okay for me to not be praying. Because if your pastor's not praying, you know, for me, I was like, well, then that's my okay to not pray. And so I get out my room. I peek into his room, kind of have my ear to the door, and I can hear him. Now, he's not a light dude. He's like 260, 270. I mean, if anybody was hot, it was this man, okay? That's what I'm trying to say. And he's in his room, and this is all I hear. This is the first thing I hear when I put my ear to the door. I hear him say, maybe he saw me. Maybe he saw me and that's why he did it. But I hear him say, and Lord, I pray for JJ. And I don't know if it was the spirit or if he was like, I pray for JJ. He said, Lord, I pray for JJ. I pray that you would use him tonight. I pray that you would give him the words to say. I pray that lives would be touched. And that's when it hit me. You know why he could pray longer than me? It wasn't because he had more tolerance than me or because he was lighter than me. It was because he was less selfish than me. When I was worried about myself and praying for myself, he was busy praying for other people. I used to be one of those people who couldn't pray longer than 10, 15 minutes max. And that's because I realized all my prayers revolved around myself. If you're the only person you pray for, you will not be able to pray for more than 15 minutes. I mean, how many problems do you really have? I mean, let's be real. Let's be real. I mean, how long can you pray? God, would you help me at home? God, would you help me at church? God, would you help me at school? God, would you, well, that pretty much covers my life, Lord. Just kind of thank you for helping me. Like, how long can you, here, you want to triple your prayer time? You want to easily, overnight, triple, double your prayer time? Pull out your cell phone, click on the address book, and start at A. God, I pray for Anthony, God. I don't know what he's going through right now, but I just pray you just touch his life. God, I pray for Brandon. God, I pray for Carissa. God, I pray for Daniel. God, I pray for Eric. God, I pray for Frank. God, I pray for George with a G. God, I pray for Harry. I pray for John, for I don't know how a name starts with I, but Inez. I don't know. I pray for Joseph. Intercession, man, it moves the heart of God, and it moves you. You can only pray for yourself for so long. You can only be about yourself for so long, and that's not what God wants us to do. I struggled a lot in my Christianity because I only understood half of it. Every time I went to church, they told me Jesus died to save sinners. So for the majority of my Christianity, I thought, well, that's great. I was a sinner, and now I'm saved. So Christianity is over. The chapter is closed. The book is done. If that's all this is about, Jesus saving sinners, then hey, I'm done. But I didn't realize that was only half the mission. The first half of the mission is Jesus saving sinners. But the second half of the mission is Jesus saving sinners, then those sinners going out to preach Jesus and save more sinners. That's how this whole thing works, 360. That's how this whole thing operates. It doesn't end with you. It ends with you going out to tell more people about Jesus. I'm gonna say something that maybe you haven't really clicked or grabbed onto yet, but camp, summer camp 2015 was never about you. You paid the registration. You got in that hot van. You showed up, you played the games, you came to the altar calls, God touched your life. But here's some perspective. Camp was never about you. It's about all the people who know you that don't know Jesus. It's about all the people who you know that don't know God. It's about your friends at school. It's about your parents. It's about your cousins. It's about your community. It's about your city. It's about your state. It's about your college campus. It's about the people that God wanted to use you to touch. I want to go to the Bible where it says Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 through 38. Matthew chapter 22, verse 37 through 38. Goes like this. If we don't have it, I'll just go ahead and read it. Matthew 22, verse 37 through 38. Yeah, there it goes. You can go ahead and look at the screen. Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment, and the second is like it. Love your neighbor as you love yourself." I'm going to ask the worship team to come up because I feel like tonight's message is a real simple message. Love God and love people. Now, I've often heard people preach this scripture and say, well, as long as I love God, well, then I should be all right. As long as I love God, well, then I should be good. Loving God is all that matters because it's the first and greatest commandment. But look what I highlighted right here. It says, and the second is like it. And the second is like it. It didn't say, and the second is less than it. Or the second is not as important as it. No, it says, and the second is like it. You know why the word second is put there? The word like there in the Greek literally means reflection. Kind of like that word another that we used last night. It literally means reflection. If I look in a mirror and there's two me's. There's the me and there's the me in the mirror. But which me came first? Me, right? Me, yeah. The second me is in the mirror, right? Now listen, the second one is like me, right? But it's not me. But it's like me. What God is saying is love God. When you love God, here's what happens. The reflection of you loving God is that you love people. That's what happens when you love people. It's not second because it's second in importance. It's second because it's what you see when you are that. When you love God from you, you should love people. You should love people. It's so important. You know, I've been a Christian my whole life. But for 17 years, I struggled with my faith. I struggled with my Christianity. I struggled with my belief because for me, and I'm just being honest, church was and Christianity was and religion was and faith was something that did not excite me because it was all about coming and getting and leaving, coming and getting and leaving, coming and getting and leaving. And it was something that for me was boring. But when I was 17, I came to a youth camp. Someone preached a message just as similar as this message here. For 17 years of my almost 30 years of life, I was a Christian. I like to tell people, but for the last 13 years, I evolved. I went from being a Christian to a Christian with a purpose. See, there are two people who need to hear this message tonight. There are two people who need the goodness of God that we've been experiencing tonight. The world and you. You know why you need this tonight? You know why you need to get it in your mind that there's a greater purpose for you? You know why you need to get it in your mind that there's a greater reason for you coming to camp to make a difference and impact lives? I have friends who are currently biking across America. They started in Tampa, Florida, drove all the way to Everett, Washington, and in Washington, they actually stood at Girls Church, one of your churches. They're doing it for women who have been caught up in sex trafficking. They're rescued from their lifestyle, and then they're put in a home where they can rehabilitate and get involved and back in society. And this organization helps house them and get them back in. And so they were raising money for that organization. And his name was Juan, and he brought four people on the back ride with him. Three of them were hardcore Jesus-loving Christians who knew the Bible inside and out. One of them was a flip-flopping Christian, somebody who had been in and out of church, somebody who wasn't living right. And I asked them on the phone just yesterday. I said, man, how's it going? How's it going with That's what happens when you give someone a purpose. See, if all you leave camp with is a blessing, let me tell you from somebody who's been to many, many camps, blessings fade. Leave camp with a blessing and it will fade. Leave camp with a purpose.
Easy to get back with your youth leader on the way out and say, hey man, camp what happens at home. The greatness of camp is determined by what happens when you get back to school. The greatness of camp is what is determined by what happens when you get back around your friends, when you get back around your family. That's when we know camp was a success. And so this is what I want to do today. I believe the young people of the Northwest Ministry Network, Youth Ministry, God has given you a gift. God has given you a call. And tonight, I believe that we're going to make an impact in someone's life. This is what I want to do in a moment. I'm going to ask every youth group, and your leaders know, and they've already planned this out. I'm going to ask every youth group to get together in a circle somewhere along here in the sanctuary, somewhere in the sanctuary. We're going to separate into our churches, and this is what we're going to do. Listen up. This is what we're going to do. Last night was awesome because we were praying for us. God filled me. God blessed me. That's cool. But tonight, we're going to take what God gave us, and we're going to release it and throw it out on our city and on our town. So if you come from Spokane, that means that tonight, you're going to get with your group of students, and you're going to begin to stand in the gap and push on heaven's gates for God to do something powerful in the city of Spokane. If there's a high school in your city, and you know that high school, you're going to just declare blessings over that high school, freedom over that high school. If you're from Everett, or if you're from Seattle, or if you're from Othello, or any small town, or big city, God's going to use you and your youth group tonight to make a difference and leave a mark and change, really change a community. It's going to happen. The Bible says, not by might or power, by my spirit, says the Lord. How many people last night, God filled you with your spirit? Raise your hand. God filled you with your spirit. You had an encounter. God gave you. Awesome. I gave an illustration. I said, listen, when I want to be filled, but I don't want to just be filled to the limit of my cup, like Psalms 23 says, right? I want my cup to overflow. That's what I want to see tonight. I think that's what God wants to see tonight. He wants to see young people full of the Spirit of God who would say, you know what, Lord? You didn't do this for me so that I can be blessed. You did this to me so that I could bless others. And this is going to be the test, all right? It's real easy to pray for you because we got issues. But can you pray for the same passion for someone else? Because prayer works. Prayer works. Cindy got out of surgery. And she's doing all right now. We're still waiting to see. But right now, the signs are pointing good. Tell me you didn't have something to do with that last night when we gathered and prayed for you at this altar. You had something to do with that. Imagine with me, if you will, this clock is broken. What time is it? 8:50. Imagine with me at 8:50. There's a girl on the cheerleading squad at your high school. And she's in her bathroom right now. Insecure because she's been violated growing up. Insecure because she's been used and abused by people in her high school. Dumped. People don't give her respect. She's talked about. They say names to her. She's had an abortion. She's just depressed. She walks into her bathroom, and behind her medicine cabinet are some pills. She looks at her pills, and she pulls those pills out. At 8:52, she pulls those pills out and asks you, and she lives in your city. She lives in Seattle. She lives in Spokane. Give me another city, because those are the ones I'm interested in. She lives in Renton. She lives in Renton. Listen, it's 8:53. Now, she lives in Renton. She's right there. She's got the pills in her hand, and she's about to take her life and end it because for her, death is better than being alive. And at 8:53, 120 kids from a church in Renton begin to cry out, God, I pray for every broken life in the city of Renton right now, that you would let them know that there's a God in heaven who loves them. And as she begins to bring the pills to her mouth, something hits her heart. And she can't explain it. All she knows is it's a moment of a purpose, a moment of love. And she begins to fall on her knees and weep and cry at 8:53, the exact same moment she was praying. She goes to church on Sunday because that's what you do when you start crying uncontrollably in the middle of the night for no reason. She goes to church on Sunday and she says, Pastor, I had a crazy experience last night. I think it was demonic. I was in my bathroom brushing my teeth. And at 8:53, something walked into my bathroom. walked into a Northwest Ministry church. The pastor looks at her and goes, what time did you say? 8:53. Well, at 8:53, there were 120 of our students praying for you at a camp in Silver Lake. I believe we serve a God who can do things like that, who can catch people on their internet while they're planning the next massacre. On their internet, on their computer, they type in bomb and it brings them to your church's website. Like, why not? They're like, how to kill a million people at the same time? New Life Youth Ministry, what? Exit. Just Jesus, the cross, pastor just pops up. Like, why not? Prayer can do it. Your prayer can do it. Your intercession can do it. What we're going to do tonight, I want you to know that it's bigger than an exercise. It's bigger than a routine. You are like a 911, like an emergency responder. When you pray, things will happen that would not have happened if you had not prayed. The Bible says that our prayers move God. How do you move God? He's a big dude. Yet that's what prayer does. Moves God. Anybody want to move God tonight? Move him in Renton, move him in Seattle, move him in Everett, move him in the state of Washington, move him. Let's move God into our cities. Let's move him into our high schools. Let's move him into our college campuses. Let's move God. God, go, rescue, deliver, save him. All the anorexics, all the bulimics, all the suicidal, depressed students in our schools, all the drug addicts. Redeem them, love them, save them now. And God can do it. There were four or five of you that came up to me last night. I was going through this, I was getting ready to pray for you because I thought you wanted me to pray for you. I was going through this, and then you said, and then I was at the altar, and God just came over my life, and oh man, I'm better. I didn't know, I thought you wanted for prayer. You came sharing a testimony. And I love that you said to me, all four or five of you, God did it. You can be in a camp 100 miles away, and God can do it. God can do it all the way over there. Anybody believe with me? We serve a God that moves. So let's do that right now. Leaders, this is what we're gonna do. I'm gonna pray for you right after I pray for you. Leaders, you know the spots in this sanctuary that you need to be in. I want you to take a second, youth pastor, youth leaders, and I want you to speak to your group first. Share your heart with your city and your town. As small or as big as it is, share your heart with those students. And then when you feel that you're ready, let's just press in and have God save lives. I want to end this like we started this. Let's put our hands over our heart right now. God gave us a new spirit last night. But tonight, he's going to give us a new heart. How do you know if you have a new heart? Well, what are you thinking about right now? Are you thinking about going home? Are you thinking about Saturday? Are you thinking about Sunday? Are you thinking about that 14-year-old girl with those pills in her hand? Are you thinking about the people that are on their way to hell? Are you thinking about all the lives that can be broken and need your help? Let's pray, God, give me a new heart. Right now where you are, come on. In your own words, let's pray, God, give me a new heart. I want to cry with people who are crying. Somebody pray that. That's a dangerous prayer. That's a dangerous prayer. Somebody pray, I want to cry with people who are crying. Because Jesus, you cried with people. I want to hurt for people who are hurting because you hurt for people who are hurting. I'm tired of being all about myself. I'm tired of being selfish. I'm tired of being all about me. I don't want to be about me anymore. I want to be about you. I want to be about you. I want to be about you. Use me, Lord. Use me, Lord. Use me, Lord. Use me, Lord. Use me. Change my heart. Do a transplant in me right now. Do a transplant in me right now. Do a transplant in me right now. Give me a new heart. Give me a new heart. Give me a new heart. Come on, Northwest. The Northwest will never be the same again after tonight. God's going to do something big. Hell is going to be on the run. Let me tell you what the devil is not afraid of. The devil is not afraid of 400 young people who are full of the power of God. No, the devil is afraid of 400 young people who are full of the power of God and who are willing to pray and to put that power into effect. That's what gets the devil on his feet and running out of his home and running out of your town and running out of your city. When those 400 young people say, yep, I'm going after God and I'm going after the devil, I'm going after every teenager that lives in my town because they belong to Jesus. Right now, God, do a mighty work. Teach us how to pray. Teach us how to intercede. Let's separate right now. Youth leaders, youth pastors, do your thing. Music will continue to play. Move chairs if you have to. Do what you have to do. Make sure you see your youth pastor, your youth leader. Remember that the success of camp is not determined by camp. The success of camp is determined what happens at home and after camp. If you don't have a church, join a church. Just get with somebody. Help them pray. Pray for your hometown right now. Go ahead, youth leaders, youth pastors. Lead this moment. Let's pray. Grow your youth group with prayer. This is how you grow your youth ministry with prayer. This is how revival breaks out in your home with prayer. Come on. y'all, let's press in. We were here till midnight praying for ourselves. Let's give just as much passion for the hurting and the broken and the lost, the depressed and the suicidal and the pregnant teenager and the abused 15-year-old girl and the kid who's getting bullied and in school and doesn't feel loved. He thinks everybody's abandoned him. Who's gonna love that guy? Who's gonna stand in the gap for that guy? Who's gonna pray for that kid? Who's gonna pray for that kid? The kid that everybody ignores. Somebody pray for that kid in your town. Stand in the gap. Stand in the gap. Stand in the gap. Well, last night when we were praying for ourselves, we went in hard. Surely we can do that for the lost. Surely we can do that for the broken, the lonely. Save Washington State. Save Washington State. Save Washington. Save Washington. Save it. Use me to save it. Use me. Use me to save my state. Use me. Save Washington. Who are crying like Jesus wept for those who are weeping. There are people weeping in your city right now. There are people weeping in your town right now. There are people who have no hope. Who have no hope. Have no hope. And there's you. Come on, is there anybody who's willing to shed a tear for those who are shedding tears tonight? There's sophomores, juniors, seniors, freshmen, just like you. Just like you. That are going through tragedies right now. Who's gonna stand up for them? Who's gonna stand up for them? Who's gonna serve them? Who's gonna pray for them? Who's gonna love them? If not you, then who? If not you, then who? Love them. Extend your hand, God. Send your spirit into that bathroom right now. Send your spirit through that computer screen right now. Send your spirit into that strip club right now. Send your spirit to that sports event right now. To that park right now, to that corner right now. Do it, God. Oh, Lord, use me, Lord. I want to see my home know Jesus. I want to see my home have hope. I stand in the gap. I stand in the gap. Make me the bridge, Jesus, for your love. Make me the bridge for your mercy.
make me the bridge.
Come on, call out your high school by name. Call out your high school by name. Something's broken on the inside. You need to look inside yourself. Ask God to change your heart. Ask God to change your heart. Ask God to change your heart. Give me a heart that bleeds with others. Give me a soft heart. Take away my heart of stone. Take away my heart of stone. Give me a heart of flesh, Jesus. A heart of flesh. Cindy's life, what you did in students' lives, what you're doing in my son's life. You do miracles. You do miracles. You do miracles. You're not done. We want to see miracles in our high school. We want to see miracles at our football events. Miracles. Move. Let me be the miracle. I'm willing. Somebody say, I'm willing. If it means I become less popular for helping out the kids that get bullied, use me. But Jesus, send your power. Send your spirit. Send them. Send them to my town. They need you. My town needs the Holy Spirit. 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 Come on, youth leaders. Show them how to pray. Come on, you want to grow your youth ministry. It's going to be through intercession. You want to grow your youth group. It's going to be through intercession. Let's pray him in the door.
how to intercede.